Marconi's first ever year-round bourbon was an inspiration. It all had to work together. A blend of carefully selected ingredients, Texas-sized pot stills, and creative people determined to find the absolute best way to usher a new whiskey along. When you discover how it pairs with a meaningful moment, suddenly the feeling of drinking great whiskey becomes a whole lot more.
Hey everybody, welcome to this week's episode of Whiskey Neat, spirited conversations with interesting people. I am your host, Kristopher Hart, and today I get to sit down with the incredibly insightful, incredibly down-to-earth native Texan Matthew McConaughey to talk about his new memoir, Greenlights. You can find the book, go to greenlights.com, go to Amazon, you can find it anywhere books are sold. The memoir Greenlights is about Matthew's upbringing, about his marriage, about his entire career. It's incredibly insightful, and I loved it. I loved every bit of it. So today I get to sit down with him to talk about his new book. Of course, Matthew is famously the creative director for Wild Turkey and launched Long Branch a couple years ago with Wild Turkey. So today I'm going to pitch to him my ideas on what should be next on the bourbon front. Our friends over at Glass River Imports, obviously you guys know Amroot, have also picked up Waterford here in the U.S. Waterford, the man behind Brooklady, Mark Reynier, believes that some of the world's greatest barley is grown in Ireland. He set out a couple years ago to launch a single farm, single origin Irish single malt whiskey and has released three expressions exclusive to the U.S. One of the things I love about Waterford and specifically is the terroir code. On the back of every bottle, on the back of the box, there is a terroir code that you can go and you can actually look up the full information of where the barley came from, where the grain was grown. I mean, top to bottom, more information than you could ever possibly want in a whiskey to tell you everything about the liquid inside. So shout out to Waterford. Waterford, our sponsors of the show, huge fan. Without further ado, please join me in a conversation with the incredibly nice, incredibly humble Matthew McConaughey. Cheers. You became the brand ambassador for, the creative director for Wild Turkey a few years ago.
Yeah.
And I don't know what that means to you, but the bourbon world is exploding right now. Mm-hmm. And everyone is champing at the bit to especially Wild Turkey. Wild Turkey is arguably one of the most well-respected, long-running family legacies. And I know how important legacies are to you. So today I'm going to jump into the book. And then at the end, I'd like to pitch to you my next three ideas for your next project with Wild Turkey.
Outstanding. I'd love to hear them.
Yes. Long Branch was a big success, but I've got three ideas. One's serious, dead serious. I think you can pull it off. The other one's kind of half serious. And the last one is definitely not serious. There's no way they're going to make it. But
all right.
I'm excited. So first off, thanks so much for coming on the show. The book was insane. It was absolutely fantastic.
Thank you.
I jumped into it. I watched your interview on Rogan, and I immediately shot myself in the foot because Rogan's first two questions were my first two questions.
Okay.
So, he asked you about this whole, you know, someone who, especially someone like Matthew, who, you know, you're often faced with an overwhelming sense of lack of privacy, constantly fighting to draw boundaries with both press and fans. You outline that in the book when you talk about how your home in Austin just kind of got burned, right, by the media and whatnot, and
everyone
knew where you lived.
Yeah. Well, that was after a late night of bongo play, and after the University of Texas Longhorns had beaten Nebraska, and I got arrested. And the editor of the newspaper, that should be news. I get it. That should be on the front page of the Metro section, but not a picture of my house with the address under it.
Sure.
Yeah.
I agree completely. But my thought though was the juxtaposition of wanting to show more of your life in a book. Did that seem weird to you at all? I know you have control. And I know, which is great because you get to funnel what gets put into the book. But did it seem odd at all when someone pitched this idea to you that, Matthew, you should do a memoir?
Well, I had been threatening, and if you've seen the beginning of the book, I wrote down in my diaries in 1989 that I wanted to write a book. I've been threatening to write a book for the last 15 years. I just didn't have the confidence to do it, or the confidence to dive into my journals and go, well, what here is worth sharing? Because 36 years worth of someone's journals does not mean it's worth sharing, no matter how damn honest they're being. There's a difference between art and self-expression. So I didn't want to just put something out there that go, hey, here's my self-expression. It's so good because I'm so honest. Oh, BS. It's got to have a story. It's got to be able to be hopefully relatable to a reader. And one of the first things I wrote down when I went off to write this book on day four, I remember writing, the words on this page need to be worthy of being signed by anonymous, but at the same time, a book that only Matthew McConaughey could have written. And yes, I often refer to myself in third person. We can get into that because I have good reason why for myself. So I didn't go, you know, the process of writing was quite freeing for sure. What I did love about it is the control. Hey, I'm an actor. I usually go do someone else's script, directed by someone else, lensed in a camera by someone else, edited by someone else. Then it's put on a screen. That's four filters from my raw expression before it gets to you in the theater. Well, I said, you know what? I want more control of that. I want more control of the truth of the stories, of the stuff that was hard, the stuff that wasn't hard. Not just revealing stuff that was hard, like I'm opening up these cryptic spots in my diary, but things that were really good. I also have to watch with my, as a celebrity, you have to watch when people exaggerate the good stuff. It's like, I remember I had a publicist after we first had our first child, and he gave this quote to People magazine, McConaughey's over the moon. And I'm like, over the moon? I don't say that. And I'm not over the moon. I have a much more sober look at it. Or like, you know, they'll if something's going well, you know, I say, oh, you know, Camille and I, my wife and I are doing really great. She's, you know, I love her more every day. They may grab that quote and go, she's the love of his life. He's never loved anything so much in his life. He would be dead without her. And you're like, oh, you're exaggerating. Hang on. Don't exaggerate the extent of what the joy is from either. So the book was a place for me to go be very honest. I had no filter in writing the book. My only filter was there's things I didn't share or things in the book that you would go, well, why didn't you go deeper into this fact? This factoid, McConaughey. Well, because if I didn't find something constructive that could be relatable to the reader could see themselves in it, hopefully, and go, huh, I'm going to take something from that in my own life. Then I didn't want to put it in the book.
Well, it's funny because you also, you start the book off, and Jimmy Kimmel kind of touched on this a little bit, but you start the book off highlighting some headlines of some things that have happened in your life. You mentioned losing your virginity via blackmail, receiving 78 stitches on the head from a vet, doing peyote in a cage with a mountain lion, and four different concussions falling out of a tree three in a full moon. My question after reading all that is, when are you going to learn to stop hanging out with Woody?
Yeah, exactly, right? And Woody would probably be on the other end of the line going, when am I going to learn to quit hanging out with McConaughey? Yeah, well, those are four examples of like, we'll go into those stories some more. And maybe I will in another book. But hey, those are true. They were moments where, you know, I'm always trying to pull things off. I you know, I've got a family now, so I don't try to be foolish with what I try to pull off. But I do like taking risks. Overall, I'm pretty savvy about what risk to take and have pulled some things off where only afterwards did I start to sweat and go, whoa. You know, I did things my younger years, which we all do. You can get away with a lot of things in your younger years because of sheer ignorance of the context of the situation. You know, maybe sometimes you don't realize the danger in the situation. I've pulled off many things because I didn't realize the context where now I'll wake up in the middle of the night with a nightmare going, oh, now that I know actually what situation I was in back then, I wouldn't have done it, but I'll wake up with in a dry sweats at night, having a nightmare about something I did when I was 16, when I didn't understand the context of how much dangerous the situation was. But I still take risk. I just take more measured risk. And I've been fortunate to pull off some things.
Yeah, you mentioned being young and getting away with those things. I think it's a certain level of ignorance and soft bones, like being able
Sure.
I mean, you detail in the book, there's a picture of you, I think, wrestling a crocodile at one point or an alligator.
And yeah, I'm the Boston Crab.
Yeah, it's just something that you can get away with when you're young. But, I mean, you have kids. Yeah, I mean, one of the things that I'd be surprised how many times my son stuck his finger in a door and, you know, got out unscathed.
Yeah.
But the book is full of moments. For me, there's two things I loved about the book. A lot of it is self-reflection. It's very introspective. And it's actually a theme within your life as early on with the treehouse, which I'll get to in a second, your time in Australia where you're there for a year thinking it's going to be one great easy trip ride. There's all of these great moments of introspective reflection that has changed your course. And I think that's one of the prevailing themes in the book. The book, the earliest of which I mentioned is the treehouse. You catalog early on how you stole enough lumber to build the treehouse, which I know has been talked about a bunch. But as a father, have you thought about building a similar place for your kids at home, giving them a place for their own self-reflection?
You mean like a treehouse for their own
treehouse, yes. Or you know, like a little fortress of solitude? I know you're a Hulk fan, but
I try to push them for that as early as possible. So the most adventurous one in our family is the most independent is our daughter. So we have Airstreams on our property. All right. We have two great oak trees in the back part of the property that we have plans to put a treehouse in, but we have Airstreams. So I'm like going, ask them all, who's the first one that's going to be bold enough to go, I want to move into the Airstream that's separate from the house. That if you want to come to the house, you got to cross the yard, go around the pool, from the porch and come upstairs and find mom and papa. I think it's going to be my daughter. That independence, I'm very excited about for her. Because as you see through the book, I believe there's great value in solitude. And that I think is really important for us to go be able to entertain ourselves with ourselves and therefore get to know ourselves better. So I have places, we have some trails where there's room, fortunately room on our property where everyone can go off and spend their solitary time. A lot of times the kids don't want to do it, right? It doesn't sound any fun to them. And Camille and I are both trying to bestow upon them the wisdom that, hey, going off, it's like a Sunday. It's kind of like going to church. Go take some inventory. It's quiet time. Don't have to do anything. Don't have a phone. We don't have a toy. We don't have a TV. We don't have a screen. Sit around. Just listen for a minute. Hear yourself think. Where does your mind go when it can go anywhere you want it to go? Those are valuable things throughout life, but also, yeah, we're trying to get our children to understand that. And to an extent, they do quite well. Not always. We have to remind them, you know, kids like to run and play and have action and eat candy and stay up all night. Well, they don't really understand that you do that too many nights in a row. It's hard to wake up and go to school Monday morning. You know what I mean? So
it's hard to get things done. Yeah.
Hard to get things done. And then, you know, you look around, you go, okay, well, that was great fun, but now we all got to go clean up, which is cool, but don't be grumpy now that we got to clean up because it's just the pay for the play, you know? So we nudge them to go have their own quiet time. My eldest son's very conscientious about this. He'll pull these impromptu yoga sessions for the family, and he's 12, and he'll pull them with his friends too. And then exercise is a form of solitude. It means you to go out and exercise and break a sweat with a ball in a competition, fatigue, to go for a run, which we push them to exercise, is a form of meditation because fatigue strips all that etcetera stuff that's on our mind out and it relaxes us and puts sort of a demarcation between the things we have going on in our life. So yeah, we push them to do all those things and most of them are doing pretty good at it so far.
Yeah, I ask because as I'm looking into your backstory, I see a lot of as creepy as this sounds, a lot of similarities. I met my wife in 2006. We got married in 2012. Yeah. We have four kids, so we're a little ahead of you.
Yeah.
But it's something that as a father, it consumes your life. And at such a young age, so our two oldest are in their teens, The two youngest are 4 and 5. And you catalog repeatedly throughout this book the relationship between you and your father and your brothers, and the only thing you ever wanted to be was a father. And so I am interested to see that side of what you're passing through. So yeah. what I mean is, and let me get to that question here. I have it written down. You and your brothers had an interesting sort of classic American machismo rite of passage with your father. Mm-hmm. Your older brothers having to physically fight him for respect. Despite this, you and your brothers understood your father in such a deep and loving way, inspiring you to say on more than one occasion, "The only thing I ever wanted to be was a father." We often learn both what to do and what not to do with our kids from our parents' behavior with us. What, if anything, have you learned from your father that you are passing through to your sons?
Oh, quite. I mean, most everything. I don't choose to. I tell stories of discipline, and they're my love stories. And hopefully I pulled off the writing enough where you see the love and the humanity come out of what would be on paper, if you just nailed out the facts, could be a horror story. Call Child Protection Services. Oh my gosh, sure. Matthew was hurt. No, I wasn't abused. No. Some of those whoopings hurt. I didn't get injured. Some of them hurt. But what really hurt each time I got those disciplines was I knew I had earned them. I knew what I had done wrong. I knew I had let my dad down. And what did we get in trouble for? And I chronicled this in the book. Don't lie. Don't say I can't. Don't hate. And respond to your own name, what you were named only. Those are four pretty good values right there. So we could say all kinds of cuss words and get our mouth washed out with soap. But if we said hate, I hate you, to our brother, or I can't, you got in trouble. And you were told, here's what it is. You're having trouble. Don't say you can't. You're having trouble. I remember this great story of my father. I had to do the chores on my Saturdays. I'm supposed to mow the lawn and weed eat it, and I was having trouble getting the lawnmower started, the push lawnmower. Try. Doesn't start it. I go inside him and I go, "Pop, I can't. Dad, I can't get the lawnmower started." And I remember he heard that word. And I knew when I said it, I was like, "Oh, it's right. I'm not supposed to say that word." And his molars met. He slowly got off the bed, walked with me outside, around the back of the house, the shed where the lawnmower was, slowly knelt down, got a screwdriver, checked some things out, found the problem. The gas line was unhooked. He hooked it back up, boom, boom, boom. A few minutes later, he starts the lawnmower. And then first words he said to me was, after the lawnmower's running, he looked at me, he goes, "You see, son, you were just having trouble." That's a great lesson in that I try to push on my children all the time, where even if we're unable to do something on our own, you don't give up. You can even go seek help to help get it done. But don't, this idea of I can't get it. Well, wait a minute. No, you're having trouble. Don't say you can't. So that was a cuss word. Hate. Told my brother I hate you at my birthday party because I had heard it at school and thought it sounded like I was older and kind of cool if you said it. My mom stopped the party. I had to lean against the wall. She gave me the belt right in front of all my friends, man. What hurt? Well, the embarrassment hurt more than the belt. And she was very clear. You never use that word. You don't hate anybody, especially your brother or someone in the family. So the values that they instilled in me are ones that I still try to instill in my children. And mind you, I do it differently than they did. Camille and I don't really like try to engage in the corporal side of punishment, but we hold them to task, and there are consequences for those things. And we explain why you don't say I can't, and why you don't hate or say you hate, why you tell the truth and why you don't lie, why you listen to your name and don't, and sign your name. And shoot, my youngest has a long name, Livingston Alves McConaughey. Well, if someone let me see, starts going, "Hey, Levy," because they don't have the effort to say Livingston, you just let them know, "No, my name is Livingston." You know what I mean? We gave you that name for a reason, and they know why each one of them are named what we named them on purpose. And I got nothing against nicknames. I'm a big nickname giver. I'm just saying, understand why you were named what you were named. When my mother My first time I got in trouble was for answering to Matt instead of Matthew on the kindergarten playground. She made it very clear right then that I named you Matthew for a reason. It's from the Bible. It means a gift of God. You are not Matt. You only answered to Matthew. Whoa. Okay. There is a lesson in that. And to this day, I still, if someone calls me Matt, I go, Matthew, please. My mom really doesn't like it. You know? So instilling those, there's values that I learned from my dad that I have taken on. Work ethic. Dad was big on work ethic. Resilience, endurance, no false drama, because the drama, real drama will come. So don't create false drama.
The art of running downhill.
Art of running downhill. Well, that's something I learned later on, because my dad, I would say, never, you know, hit that lick in business where we were really affluent. We were sort of always middle class, and dad never, you know, when he passed away, he was close to bankrupt. You know, now me, I got extremely successful. My bank account was getting filled and I was getting offers to do what movies I wanted to do. And I noticed that I tried to self-sabotage myself. Like, I didn't deserve it, you know? That's why I talk about the art of running downhill. Sometimes things are going so well, you get nervous. Like, is this legal? Can it be going this good? Have I earned this? Do I deserve it? And if you don't feel like you do, you'll trip yourself. I've done it. I've tripped myself. Bam, face plant. And then look up and go, oh, did I really need to fall? Did I really need to butt break my nose and get a bloody nose that I did to myself, self-inflict this to feel like, oh, now I feel like I've earned it. Now I feel like I deserve it. No, that's not really a smart thing to do. Let's be graceful with success and trust again. The uphill's coming. Now, maybe when it feels like you're on easy street. So that's what the art of running downhill chapter's about. But there's a lot of things that my father passed down to us. Loyalty was a big one.
Yeah, the self-fulfilling prophecy aspect of self-sabotage is something that I think is an easier to translate, easier to convey by saying the art of running downhill, by explaining it through that. As I'm the whole time I'm listening to this chapter, you know, I've got two daughters in high school, and hearing how they all have their own set of problems that sometimes they are problems, but sometimes they're not problems. Sometimes it seems like they're self-sabotaging. And I have to talk to my daughters and as most fathers should, just to kind of explain, like, hey, this is, you're doing this to yourself. Life can be very difficult. So there were moments that I would read in the book, and I'm from Texas, I'm born and raised in Houston, that I immediately, it related to something to do with either my own marriage or within my own kids. And it's one of the reasons why I think there's a reason why your book is just hit number one, best time, number one,
New York Times bestseller.
Yeah. I just totally fumbled that. But yeah, it's a massive, massively relatable book about real honest upbringings.
I hope so, man. I mean, that, you know, and for the book to be a New York Times number one bestseller makes me feel good, because I go, oh, okay, it's translating. You know, when writing the book, I found that the more personal I got, the more into the I that I went, the more relatable it became. And I was feeling like when I was writing it, whoa, this is, if you're going more into the personal side, the more personal you get, McConaughey, does that make it more just really for you of your own journals and less relatable? But it was the inverse. The more personal I got, it was like, oh, this exposes how my experiences are just examples of the human condition that anyone can relate to.
Yeah, very common. In fact, so one of the things I did want to ask you about is, I know you grew up very religious upbringing, and the book is full of self-reflection that have led to a lot of life choices. While traveling the world to find yourself in these locations, did you feel like this was fate or a pre-planned, like God trying to set you on a predetermined path? Or did you feel like this was more your own inner being realizing that you weren't doing what you should be doing?
Right. Well, you know, I don't know where you live on the line of belief on your own religious beliefs, but for me, that's a great question, because they go like this, and then sometimes I go, well, no, it's self-determination, but in that split second, as take the action, oh, then it was written. It's like everything we just did prior to this interview to right now, you look back and go, oh, I get it. It's a science. It all adds up. I understand how we got here. I understand why I asked the question. I understand why I answered that way. And here we are. Going forward's the mystery. So it's like, when do we feel like it was written? I question that all the time. I don't know. After it's done, I always feel like it was written. And going back and looking over 36 years of journals, I'm like, oh, I see the design. I see the plan. I see where those times were. I didn't understand what the hell was going on or how this was going to connect to the lineage of my story. Ah, I see how that was connected now. Ah, is that fate? Was that written predetermined? I question that all the time. I do go into the book. In the book, I go into it quite a bit about, I think we can go, and I have gone to the extremes on there. You know, if I've been overly a fatalist in my life, where I kind of felt like, oh, it is all written. It's all pre-planned. So run all the red lights. If you go, you go. Well, that's a foolish thing to do. And then I've had times where, which I still lean into, which is like, no, we're all self-determining individuals. We have our hands on the wheel. We make choices. Those choices matter. We're driving our car. We're driving our vehicle on our highway of life. What we do and what we don't do, how fast we drive, when we speed up, when we slow down, when we take pause, that's on us. Now, when I've crossed more truths in my life, I feel like that fate and my self-determination are in simpatico. I feel like they're running right there next to each other. I don't feel like they're separate things. So just as I choose it is just as I realize it's been written. And I feel in present with the story that I feel has been written for me, that I am also writing with it. And sometimes, you know, there's a larger gap between those two. Sometimes I feel very disconnected from God and I just have to go, hey, really, this is all about self-determination. I have a story in the book of 2 years where I went into my agnostic years of going, no, I'm letting myself off the hook. Actually, I'm letting myself off the hook on personal responsibilities because I'm kind of half-assed relying on the fact that, oh, what, you know what, you know, God loves me anyway. He's got my back. You know, what'll happen. It's all been written. Well, I was making excuses for myself in that. And we can all do that sometimes as believers. So I was calling myself to task, not so much challenging the existence of God as much as I was putting my own ass on the line going, hey, quit giving yourself you're asking yourself to forgive yourself too many times for the same things. You're becoming a repeat offender. And that's not cool. You're taking advantage of this idea of your belief in fate.
Yeah, I grew up very religious. We grew up Pentecostal in Houston. I did the same thing as I got older. I kind of loosened my feelings on a lot of things. I breathed a little bit. I exhaled. But the book largely does feel fated. Your career path, your choices you've made felt like such good choices, such conscious decisions you made that it seemed impossible for it not to be predetermined. It was just so weird.
And where those two would seem like the contradiction, because you see in the book, and I've had quite a few people come tell me, I had no idea you were so intentional, so deliberate, Matthew. And I'm like, yeah, but those two would seem to be contradictions. But they're actually not, I don't believe. You know, I don't think that self-determination and predetermination, that they're not really a contradiction. They are more of a paradox. Maybe they're Matthew 6:22 in that little third eye overlap. Yeah.
You told a story once about your dad one Christmas driving up 59 into Houston to buy a $20,000 Rolex from a grifter for pennies on the dollar, and how it inspired your idea for Kenny Wells in the film Gold.
Yeah.
Likewise, the character Wooderson in Dazed and Confused was also inspired by your brother Pat. Two questions. Where in Houston did you guys live? Because I didn't
know. Quail Valley.
Okay. All right. And are there any other people in your life that have been inspiration for characters besides Pat and your dad?
Yeah, there's many. And you know, the interesting thing about those two stories is, and I write about this, is about definitions and impressions. That's not that one for Gold for Kenny Wells. That's not who Kenny Wells was, not who that Chicago John, that 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 dealer who sold my dad a, you know, $20,000 Rolex, which was actually, you know, a $500 Rolex, you know, he was not, that was not it. But that impression on that rainy day with my father at 20 years old, with the car still running because, hey, we might have to get out of here, flashing the lights at the guy pulling up and this guy getting out in rain, sleet in a black leather jacket. Not a real rain, like a black leather jacket, like a short one, the one you don't wear in the rain, the one that it's you wear it in the rain because it's the only one you got, that guy. And then opening up the back of a van, looking around, my dad seeing the back side of him and his elbow going like this. And that motion, I knew he was counting off bills. And while he's doing that, comeback wrapped up. And on the highway, driving back with him after he told me to put it in the glove box, and I'm thinking it's a damn King Cobra or something. I don't know what the hell's in there, man. He's like looking up like Ray Liotta in the Scorsese film. Like, are the cops chasing me in a helicopter? Hell no, they're not chasing a helicopter. But my dad loved the idea that he was his own mobster and his own gangster. So all, everything I just told you was my impression of that that led to
that moment.
This is who Kenny Wells is. On the other side, Wooderson was not who my brother Pat was. My brother Pat to this day goes, gee, thanks, dude. Come on, you know, and I, when they go, oh, it's based on me, he's like, oh, thanks a lot. Oh, I wasn't hanging around the high school girls, you know. And I go, yeah, but when I was 8, we went to pick you up. I saw you from 60 yards away leaning against the wall in the smoking section. And you were my big brother, my hero. You looked 12 feet tall at that time. You were silhouetted. The way you were smoking that cigarette. The reason I didn't tell mom I saw you because I knew you'd get in trouble for smoking a cigarette. That image, to me, was monumental. That was Wooderson, that impression. So I've had many other impressions. And it's part of the reason I've loved to travel. I've met so many people in so many different walks of life. The challenge with the travel is meeting people that can behave honestly with me because I come in with certain fame, celebrity, they've seen me before. It takes some tricks to get people to actually come down and be involved in a conversation with me and be themselves. So to find that natural and honest behavior in my travels is sometimes a challenge, but I've seen all kinds. So I've had lots of different people, you know, that are bits of characters that remind me also of those parts of myself. Because ultimately any performance is actually not an actor being someone else. It's an actor being really doubling down on that part in themselves.
Yeah, it's something that I thoroughly enjoyed. Kenny Wells, to this day, I went back. There were a couple films that I actually hadn't seen that you had done. Yeah, I'm 33, I think 32, 33, one of those two, 87.
Yeah, sure.
So there are a couple films I hadn't seen. I went back and I didn't know you were in Texas Chainsaw Massacre, and I got to relive
the next generation.
I got to relive a childhood trauma. I remember as a kid walking in the living room to see my stepfather watching the film, and there was this moment where this guy with a mechanical leg stands on a woman's head, and you hear the gears, the hydraulics pushing down until her head crushes. And that has stuck with me.
It has?
For 25 years. I've never forgot that. I went back to watch the movie and realized that you were the guy with the mechanical leg. I'm telling you, I've had so much fun over the past month just diving into things I didn't know about you, things I thought I knew about you. The interview you did with Tim Ferriss was fantastic. You talk about a little bit about you. He asked you a similar question about, I think it was who your dad has been inspired you like a character. And I knew you were going to say Kenny Wells.
Because
I remember that story. I remember that story.
Yes, yes, yes.
One of the things you talk about in 2017 is that you met a woman 5 years into acting that helped guide you, and you worked with her for another 19 years.
Yep.
I imagine she was with you every step of the way through the world travel to find yourself, as well as the birth of the McConaissance. My question is, was she nervous or scared for you through these things, these decisions to pull away? I mean, I know you talked about what you and your wife discussed.
Right.
But, well, and absolutely, and how amazing did it feel when you turned out to be right?
Well, her name was Penny Allen. So Don Phillips, the man I met in the bar in Austin, Texas in 1992, in the summer of 92, who I introduced myself to. He was a casting director for Dazed and Confused. At the end of the night, asked me if I ever done any acting, and if so, I might be right for this part in this movie called Dazed and Confused. The role was Wooderson. That man, whose couch I slept on when I drove out to Hollywood a year and a half later, is the man that told me in 1997, because I'd never taken acting classes, really, serious ones anyway. He goes, time to cut your handicap, McConaughey, using a golf term. Time to lower your handicap. What do you mean? He goes, you got the instincts, you know, you got a natural ability, but I think it's really time to learn and understand the craft of acting. I got this lady. She's a baller. She's wild. She's highly intimidating, but she's what you need. I think it's going to be right. That lady was Penny Allen that Don introduced me to. Penny Allen became a mentor to me. I don't even know how to explain her. And anyone else out there listening to this that has worked with Penny Allen will probably say the same thing. We don't know how to explain her. And now she has since moved on. Cancer got her. But for 19 years, that's who I went to. And I learned my rights as an actor. I learned how to break down a script. I learned how to get out of trouble if I felt tense in a scene. How to get out of trouble if I had a director want me to do things that I didn't want to do. How to take real, true ownership of my man. How to come into every scene so damn prepared that I had four versions of the truth. And I don't care what anybody else does. Bring it on. Do not even yell cut. I'll know my man well enough to be my man. Now, I was intimidated every single time, and I've seen her thousands of times, when we would go to work on a script. Because no matter how confident I was, she'd break it down and break me down. And I'd break a sweat every time we worked. And every time I showed up at her house to go work, we always did her house, I'd have to catch my breath before I go in, going, this is going to get bloody. And I'd go in, and 3 hours later, come out and like, yes, felt so much more ownership and identity of the character and gained so much confidence. She is the one who really helped me become the actor that I've become. She also was a lady who had no idea. She was in Hollywood, didn't understand like the idea of taking off 2 years or however long it was going to take to not do rom-coms. Her whole mind never worked from like, well, that might not be good for business. No, she's always for like, well, what do you need to do? She was always trying to say, what is true to you, Matthew? And she knew when I told her, I'm feeling like I'm just an entertainer right now. And she'd be like, so what's so bad about that? And I'd be like, well, you're right. Nothing. You know what I mean? Life's good. I do like entertainment. I feel like these films I'm doing, these rom-coms are really nothing but entertainment. And I want to, she goes, well, then stop doing them.
So that's she was supportive.
That's what I'm here to tell you. I'm going to stop doing them. She goes, she always said this when I would come up with those decisions. She would always be like, you know. She goes, you know how much trouble people get into when they start listening to other people? You know. Now quit talking about it. Just go do it. Boom. So she was part of a help in that decision and was fully supportive of it. So then I come back and we work and then, you know, we got after years of working together, she started saying like, look, you know all this stuff. You don't even need to work with me anymore. I was like, oh, yes, I do. And then it was very scary when she passed away because I was like, oh, she was my secret weapon. But she told me before she passed, she was like, you've known all this stuff all along. I pulled it out of you. You're not going to forget it. It's in you. Trust that. And I still try to take that work ethic with me, but it has been intimidating since she moved on to not have her to go with to work on a character and acting. It's been scary to wonder, the way I work on a character is I have a dialogue with her and say to myself what I think she would say and challenge myself in the way that I think she would challenge myself, but she's not physically here to do that anymore.
Right. Well, so she knew from the beginning, you knew from the beginning, there was no one scared about you pulling away. I was actually expecting you to be like, they were all telling me not to pull away. And then when I ended up being right, it felt great.
No, the only, look, and I tell it in the book, even my agent who I called who, Minder, I'm doing romantic comedies, getting paid a lot of bank. Agencies get 10% of that bank. So when you're, when, you know, when they've got a horse named McConaughey who's just laying down romantic comedies and bringing in a lot of money to their agency, that when I call him and say, I'm not doing rom-coms anymore, that agent has every right to go, oh no, wait, 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 no, 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 that's not a good idea. He didn't. He knew me well enough. He goes, great. And I even challenged him. I was like, wait a minute, why so quickly are you on my side? He goes, I said, what are you going to say to your bosses when you go in there on Monday morning and say, my client, Matthew McConaughey, is saying no more romantic comedies, which have been bringing in big digits of money into our agency. And he goes, I don't work for them. I work for you. It was that quick, cut and dry. My money manager, how am I doing with my money? I'm not going to be working for a while. He goes, you've saved your money well. You've been very fiscally conservative. You're okay to take off for a while. Then there was the many tears I cried with my wife to go, hey, I'm going to stop doing those rom-coms and the things I want to do, the dramatic fare, they're not offering me. I don't have the opportunity to do those. So I don't know how long I'm not going to work. Well, as you see in the book, I went 20 months with no work. And the only people, the only resistance I got was the good-hearted family resistance from my brothers and my mother, who, when they heard about offers I turned down, major, major money offers, they were like, what is wrong with you, boy? We grew up like, you get a chance to work and make good money, you go do it. Yeah. And they were like, you turned that down? And I'm like, yep. But they knew me well enough to know me well that I had made the decision for myself and my soul. And while they thought I was, they always knew I was somewhat out of my mind, but thought it was a crazy choice I was making to take a sabbatical from Hollywood, they respected it.
You mentioned your wife's support, who seemed to have got it right away. In marriage and life, we often have revelations of what makes it all come together. The behaviors and mindsets we develop and hold dear in our relationships that we come to realize is simply how it's supposed to be. As a happily married man and father of four myself, when I research guests like you, and I find myself picking up on some of the beautiful traits in others that I cherish in my own marriage. Your wife, like mine, seems to understand you in such a profoundly deep and loving way, enough to let you disappear for almost 2 months into the desert so you could write a book, you know?
Yeah.
So
she's the one that kicked me in the backside and said, get out of here and don't come back until you got something.
And that's such a, reading the relationship between you and Camilla just seemed to be such a relaxed and understanding relationship, to say the least. If you did have to give a tip out there, I know this is kind of a teen magazine question, but if you did have to give a tip out there for the longevity of love in relationships, because being a major celebrity, for you guys to be together for 14 years, and then of course your relationship with Penny and your relationship with Nicole, you're a publicist, you've worked, you have this near 20-year relationship with everybody around you. What would you say would be the key to longevity in those both working and personal relationships?
Well, in the working relationship, we've got to produce. We have to make it happen. You know, we have to create content. The proof has to be there. We have to be competent at the work. Nicole, my assistant, is incredibly competent at her work. But another thing that's great that her and I have is, if she does screw up on a scheduling thing, if she screws up on something, she's just like, yep, that was on me. My bad, screwed up. And I know that it's not for lack of effort. Now, if you got someone who's screwing up all the time and you go, well, they keep doing that, and it's kind of like they're just being lazy. Maybe they don't give enough of a damn. Well, that relationship's probably not going to last work-wise. But if someone screws up and be able to go, yep, that was me. I screwed up. And I'm like, great, got it, moving on. Never holding that over her or on her, because I know it wasn't for lack of effort. So that's for a working relationship that's been very good for her and I. Look, in relationships, say like with Camilla, sense of humor is a doozy, a real important one. But we know each other enough. And I believe this is true. People are essentially who they are. You know, I mean, yes, we change and evolve, but we evolve just in different branches off the trunk of the tree that we were born with. She knows me well. I know her well. We don't push each other to be something that we're not, or something that the rest of the world thinks we ought to be. It takes work being in a celebrity position that I'm in and she's in, because we have to keep our bubble, our cocoon. It's easy to listen to the rest of the world. It's easy to, you know, go away and see things that we go, oh, that's a good idea. Oh, that's a temptation. But then to say, wait a minute, that's a short-term one. That if I did that, that would be a fad. Her and I together trying to make legacy choices as a couple as well, about what choices can we make together today and how can we love each other and promote and push each other to be more ourselves. That those choices are going to be ones that we look back at in 10 years, 20, 40, 100 and go, yeah, that was the right kind of support. And then the balance of sometimes I'm the one, you know, living with me can be tough, man. Sometimes all applause or the trophies kind of get handed to me, where she may have been my teammate the whole way, but they're handing them only to me. And maybe they should actually someplace should be handing them to her. But she understands that happens sometimes. We don't spite each other. We don't compete with each other in that way. And she's, you know, she tells me she gets a lot from being able to support me in the way that she does. And I hope I'm being able to do the same with her, is push her enough to be more of herself. And, you know, right now, a lot of our job, we got 3 kids, you got 4. A lot of the job at this time, for those 18 years that kids are in a household, it's parenting. And Camille and I go through it all the time. The old 10 p.m. at night, you finally go, oh, hi, how you doing? Hadn't checked in all day. We were busy from the get-go. The kids were doing this and we had to handle this and that and the other. But she's also very good about reminding me for us to have our solo time and check in with each other.
Especially during this coronavirus, you guys have been stuck in the house together. Yeah. I personally loved it at first, and then about a month into it, I'm ready to pull what's left of my hair out. Yeah. And then we pushed past that. We're now 6 months, 8 months into this, and I love it again. What have you, and this is kind of just a random question, hearing you talk about it. Have you picked up on any vices at home while you guys are stuck at home? I mean,
any vices?
Yeah. Like I started smoking cigars again. It'd been a while. Right. I had a couple sticks on the back patio enjoying this good weather.
Well, that's not a bad vice. look, I've already got, you know, I don't know how puritanical we're going to be about vices. I'm a fan of certain things that some people call vices, to an extent. In some ways, I've gone a little more the other way during this time, meaning got myself in better shape. I do miss my Sunday church in person, that time that I like to do inventory, but I think I've stayed, you know, pretty spiritually sound and strong through this. And a lot of that's through, we're saying more prayers before meals because the family's sitting down together for more meals, lunch and dinners.
And it makes the food taste better.
It at least makes the food taste better. Just the old gratitude. No, I don't think so. Look, you know, getting through this COVID thing, I know what you mean about it. You liked it at first and you didn't, now you do. It's a different rhythm, and you got to make sure everyone personally has their own different rhythm, but then you have to understand the rhythms of the day for each other as a couple. You got to understand the rhythms of the day for the kids. You got to create structure so every day doesn't feel like a freaking Saturday. You know what I mean? And you don't know if it's sun up or sun down. You got to have some structure or it'll just spin out of control. So we've been pretty good to try and settle into the rhythms of what do we actually need to do. Come down, you know, a long time ago, we came down off that sort of ghost anticipation of, oh, well, I'm going to go. Oh, that's right. It's COVID. We're not going to do that. You know, so I don't anticipate doing anything other than what I'm doing now daily. We also have my 88-year-old mother with us. So that's a different kind of caretaking, although she's pretty damn self-reliant. We've slipped into our own little rhythm and our own little bubble. And what we're trying to tell ourselves and the kids is, instead of thinking this is going to be over tomorrow, what if this isn't over for another 3 years, 5 years, 10 years? Who knows? I don't know, but mentally to get prepared for that being a long shot possibility, that does help you settle into rhythm and conserve some energy going through this time.
So to pivot slightly, I had a question I wanted to ask. At the tail end, I thought I had all my questions lined up. I hear that there's a rumor that I had to just address. And if you can address it, that'd be great. I know there's probably not much you can say, but what is this rumor I hear of you joining the Marvel Cinematic Universe as Norman Osborn? What, if anything, can you say?
I know nothing except I've read it. It's popped up on my news for me quite a few times.
Well, I know.
Maybe they're thinking of me. So if that rumor's going, they are maybe getting that out there. Maybe word got out of their office that they're thinking of me, but no one has contacted me directly about that. And I've heard nothing from my representation about
that. Well, I know that you had talked to Josh Horowitz about potentially throwing your hat in the ring to be the Hulk back in 2012-ish, 13. Have you thought about joining this now more than any, you know, now more than ever, the Marvel Cinematic Universe is destroying the box office. Have you thought about joining? Would you consider it?
I'd consider it. I mean, a few other things came my way. I won't say the name that have been made and have been successful. I'd consider it. It's not something that I wake up going, oh, I've got to.
I've got to be a Thor, yeah.
You know, but I'd sure consider it. You know, and especially I think now having children, you know, little things like I just caught up over quarantine with Lord of the Rings. Wow. I did not know. And I'm like, yeah. So that fantastic world, I'm much more open to now. And as long as if it's good mythology, yeah.
Yeah. Lord of the Rings, I think it's easy to give them credit for starting the, I know Iron Man kind of gets credit for, you know, our Robert Downey Jr.'s portrayal seems to have launched the Marvel Cinematic Universe. But I think that the type of popcorn movie with these massive budgets and these massive, Lord of the Rings started that. I can't think of a movie before that, that really kind of set the stage for what we have now. I'm excited. That's the only reason I wanted to bring it up because I do like the idea of seeing you within the Spider-Man realm, especially with Tom Holland being a beast that he is. Let's talk bourbon. If you got a minute about bourbon. So
let's talk bourbon.
I know you, your bourbon journey was a massive success for Wild Turkey. You kind of became the creative director for Wild Turkey, releasing Long Branch, I think in 2018, 2017, somewhere in there. Leads me to wonder what's next, you know? So Wild Turkey is an extremely well-loved brand within the bourbon hobbyist world. You know, you have brands that sell cases upon cases of, you know, your $20 bourbons. Then you have brands that have the nerd, the whiskey nerd, kind of like how you talked about how in film class you had these goth kids who wanted to write off Bruce Willis because, you know. So Wild Turkey covers both worlds. They've got the affordable everyday for the novice, but they also have this legacy that is so well loved and quite fanatic around it.
Right.
I want to know what's next for Long Branch. And are you going to be launching another round of something new? And if so, I have some ideas I want to run by you real quick, if you're open to them.
I would love to see your ideas. Look, we just, the journey so far with Long Branch, and if, you know, Eddie Russell and I worked on this juice for 2 years. Which was a great and really fun thing to be able to do, to be able to sit there and receive little pints of different concoction of the juice over 2 years and save those for the Friday night and then sit around the fire and have them and take notes, tasting notes for 2 years. I think I started to enjoy it so much that Eddie was kind of thinking, are you just sending these notes back because you're enjoying this so much? But we got to this juice that's in this bottle, Long Branch. The whole goal from the beginning was, hey, what's going to be my favorite bourbon, which is what we got in the bottle. As far as what we put out marketing-wise, you know, we went with the It'll Find You early on. I directed some of those ads and wrote them. Ad world has changed quite a bit. And how much has it forever changed now with, you know, how we're talking now? I'm not in studio. How much has it forever changed? So we also said, like this last run, I just was itching to go, let's have a little bit of wry humor to this thing, to the ad campaign, it doesn't need to be a high production value. We don't need to go to, my son was the DP on this last set of Long Branch ads.
When you were in the field?
Yeah, that's me and my son Levi with two GoPros, and he's 12 years old. So I've started to employ my kiddos, all three of them, to be my production crew on these things. We are going to start leaning into sharing the story and Long Branch out there more now. It did come out of the gates. We are getting some traction. People do seem to like it, and they're very excited about the price point that you get it for. So the next step, I don't know. And if I do know, I can't really tell you right now. I've got some ideas as far as what the next evolution of Long Branch is. And we're discussing those right now, but ones I can't quite share just yet.
Okay. All right. So I've got some
stuff. What's your ideas?
I've got some stuff to throw in the realm of possibility here. So we've got two cameras here. Of course, you and I are talking via webcam, but the actual studio camera, I want to make sure you can see it. So Brandon, just let me know. So this first thing is half joking, half serious. I think the project is doable. However, hold on one second here. Let me grab a sheet. The project is doable, but obviously the packaging can change, the wording can change. Mm-hmm. Bruce Russell, met him early on when he was pioneering the Russell Reserve brand. He is big in the rye world. The bourbon community absolutely loves Wild Turkey's rye. So, first project here. Can you see that? We even mocked up some, borrowed a picture of Matthew there to throw up. Can you see it good? So it's a 13-year-old.
Yeah.
13-year-old rye. Now, the name of it is All Rye, All Rye, All Rye.
Yes, so, yes.
Got to work that in there.
All Rye, All Rye, All Rye.
13. The idea is a 13-year-old rye from Russell's Reserve, a special edition bottling at a decent proof. Obviously, anything above 100 proof, Wild Turkey shines at. But it says 13, a number that has been special to Matthew for a long time. It symbolizes reinvention, slowing down, discarding your past and what you thought you knew, and putting aside the noise of the world to focus on the current moment and the wonders in front of you. We hope you enjoy Matthew's limited edition blend of 13-year-old straight rye whiskey. Be bold, be present, and keep on living.
I like it. I would even play maybe into the number 13, into that it's historically an unlucky number, but how we're flipping the script, because the all right, all right, all right, just when you thought it was a downfall, have a sip, it'll be your upfall. 13 is good for you.
I mean, listen, it's flowing out of you. I love these brainstorming sessions.
I did.
It's where beauty comes out. All right, so the next
one. That looks like a winner.
The next one is a easily doable. This can be done. Dead serious pitch, right? So in the Wild Turkey brand was made iconic via the Wild Turkey 8-year-old 101 proof offering. My argument, my pitch to you, is to bring back the Wild Turkey 8-year 101 proof brand. Now, currently you can buy the 101 proof bottling that's non-age stated for about $20. Mm-hmm. Bring back the 8-101. Just to give you an example, the old 8-101s, as Jimmy and them can attest to, they trade for quite a bit of money online, some as many as $1,000. The old 8-year 101 proof. I think Matthew can relaunch the 8-101 brand, and I think that is a damn fine looking picture there.
I really like this one. It's a good looking bottle. 8-101 looks very, very exclusive.
Yeah, I'm digging it. Okay, last one. All right, so we touched on it earlier. You mentioned several times throughout the book that when something wasn't right in life, you had the same reoccurring wet dream.
Yes.
Changed your life.
Yes.
Right? So my pitch to you is...
I can't wait for this one. Nocturnal Revelations.
It's a Wild Turkey Master's Keep. It says Kentucky straight bourbon finished in your sleep. I don't know what Wild Turkey would be open to something like this, but look at that. That looks great.
Oh, no, that's definitely a, that's an exclusive item there, baby.
Nocturnal Revelations. People would pay good money for that. I'm telling you.
Find out,
just to find out what it tastes like.
Or just to find out what happened in their sleep that night.
So, I appreciate your time today. It's been a blast. Let me make sure. Oh, there is one other question I wanted to ask you. Random. This is an old personal question. Total pivot. You exude confidence. You exude comfortable. Like, no matter the situation, Matthew is very comfortable. Was there a time, and have you ever embarrassed yourself in front of another celebrity where you were nervous and? I looked for it. I couldn't find any discussion of this. Was there ever a time in which Matthew?
Yeah. Look, I remember my favorite filmmakers, the Coen brothers. Well, my manager gets me set up for this dinner with the Coen brothers, the directors, and John Malkovich.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah, I'm getting nervous right now. I sat there and I knew the Coen brothers films upside down and backwards. You know, Raising Arizona, my favorite comedy. It could go on and on and on and on and on. And I got in that meeting and I choked. You know, that feeling where you feel like, boy, if I just need to find the gap to say something in this conversation, it's got to be really good. And when you're looking for that gap to say something really good, you're not actually listening to the conversation naturally. And I didn't blow the meeting, but I sucked in the meeting. I was like, I wasn't even me. They don't know me any better. And when I did say something, I think they could tell I was probably just trying to get that in for, like, you know, I was nervous. So I blew that meeting and have not worked with Coen brothers, but would still like to, but they've never called to ask me to work with them. But if that meeting would have gone better, I bet I might've already worked with them.
So the last thing we'll do, and it's a little odd because you're not in studio. These interviews are usually over a few drinks. I've definitely been drinking casually here, listening to you talk. And one of the things we do is I'll try to find a birth year bottle. And it's significant because everything you've ever accomplished in your 50 years on this planet, that liquid has been sitting in that little time capsule for the past 50 years. And it gets to get opened and you get to experience it from before you were born until now, everything that's happened. Back then, landing on the moon was your birth year, right? 69. Mm-hmm. So I found a bottle of Wild Turkey 8101 from 1969. I actually had to grab it from the Netherlands. I have a buddy in the Netherlands. Shout out to Martin. But he sent me a full bottle from 1969. You're not here for us to share it, so I'm going to open it and toast to you without you.
Deal.
I hope to see you again one day, and we can share a pour from it. But in the meantime, I just wanted to say thanks.
Yes, you're welcome, and thank you. And yeah, save that so I can be there in person. We can sip that together one day, huh?
Absolutely. Next time you're in Houston, we'll see you. Cheers.
Just keep living, all right?
Have a good one, Matthew. Thank you.
You too. Ciao now.
Balcony's first ever year-round bourbon was an inspiration. It all had to work together. A blend of carefully selected ingredients, Texas-sized pot stills, and creative people determined to find the absolute best way to usher a new whiskey along. When you discover how it pairs with a meaningful moment, suddenly the feeling of drinking great whiskey becomes a whole lot more.